Hello everyone and welcome to my latest review of His Dark Materials, Season 1, Episode 4, Armour. Sorry for the delay with this review, I got kind of distracted reviewing the new series of Doctor Who, but I thought I'd better catch up with my reviews of His Dark Materials, and here we are, Episode 4. So the basic plot of this episode is as follows. As the Egyptians head up north, Lyra searches for allies and comes across an armoured bear named Yorick Bernison and an aeronaut named Lee Scoresby. There we go, that's the basic premise of what goes on in episode 4. So, Armour, the fourth episode of this season. Fantastic, another great episode. This is where the show really starts to get great. This is where it really starts to kind of hook me in. I mean, the first few episodes are a little slow, but they do slowly draw you in, and now the exciting stuff happens. For me, what is fantastic about this is the fact that we get introduced to one of the central characters in this show, Yorick Bernison, who is a armoured bear. We discover that he's living in Trollesund, and he has been deceived to and lied to, and his armour has been taken away from him. And Lyra makes a deal with him in order to get his armour back, and she uses the alethiometer to do so. Instantly, we see a bond between Lyra and Yorick, and I have to say, the CGI for Yorick is incredible. It looks, honestly, like Hollywood standard. It looks like the BBC have thrown most of their budget into the CGI. And for Yorick, they wanted to make sure it looked especially good. And this character, he's going to be quite substantial in this first season. And he is voiced by Joe Tandberg. I've never heard of Joe Tandberg before, but he puts on a good voice. He has this low, booming voice, Yorick Bernison. Yeah, he's quite well-spoken, but you can see he's just a very damaged character. And you do feel some sympathy for him, and he wants to actually get revenge on the people that stole his armor, and he tries to kill them. But Lyra, being the moral person that she is, tells him that it's best to just walk away and not kill everyone. So I really do like the character of Yorick, and he will get quite a lot more to do in the forthcoming episodes. We're also introduced to Lee Scoresby, who's played by Lin-Manuel Miranda. And I kind of thought at first, when I heard he was playing this role, I thought, oh, okay, typically cast in this role because he's big. As in, he's a big, well-known actor. But to his credit, actually, Lin-Manuel Miranda actually makes this character very charming. In the film The Golden Compass, Sam Elliott played this role, and he did a decent job, but he didn't have much to do because the movie was kind of all over the place. And I also think maybe Sam Elliott was probably a bit too old to play the role. I don't know what the age is meant to be in the book, but I just thought he was kind of old to play the role. But I really like Lin-Manuel Miranda as Lee Scoresby. He adds a certain degree of charm. He's basically a cowboy of the skies. It's like he's an aeronaut, but he dresses and acts like a cowboy. But he really does take to Lyra. They do form an instant friendship, and she manages to make a deal with him because he knows Yorick. She makes a deal with Scoresby to help them get Yorick to join the fight in bringing the kids back. So I really like the introduction of the two new characters, and obviously Lee Scoresby has a demon called Hester, who's like this rabbit. And she talks to him quite a lot. She's quite amusing as well. There's actually quite a lot of action in this episode. There's quite a few action scenes. There's this big bar fight which goes on between Scoresby and everyone else. He's in a typical kind of Western fashion. He walks into the bar trying to get a drink, and he tries to discover information about Yorick and where his armor is. He's just trying to help Yorick, and in the end he gets thrown out of the pub. But there's a great fight sequence which happens, and you remember my previous review, I criticised the fight choreography in Coulter's flat. This episode fixes that. They have much better fight choreography. The direction is a lot better, I think. It's definitely slicker this time with the fight choreography. And the final action scene when Yorick storms into the church to get his armour back, and he's about to kill everyone, and he's throwing guys around and everything. It's quite a thrilling sequence. It really is great to watch. Considering it's on a TV budget, they've done a great job to make it look realistic. I mean, the setting of this particular episode is set in this town called Trollesund. It's this kind of run-down, almost kind of shanty town-looking place. It's not a very nice place to live. It looks kind of run-down, and it looks like everyone's kind of poor there, and there's not many resources there. Yorick was there working because he was strong. He could work with metal, and that's why they've kept him prisoner there, basically, and they got him drunk and they manipulated him and they lied to him, which is very tragic to hear. So he has quite a tragic story, really, and he's kind of been excommunicated from the bears, which we find more out. We find out more about that later on. We also see that Mrs. Coulter is trying to hold on to every ounce of her power that she has, because the Magisterium are going to strip away her authority from being head of the Oblation Board. But she doesn't want that. No, no, no. She wants to be in control. So she tries to manipulate them into thinking that she can control Lord Asriel and bring him to them. Sorry. Of course, this is all a coup, because she goes to talk to the King of the Bears at the very end of the episode, Ragnarsson, I think his name is, and she says, I will offer you a place in the Magisterium if you let me control Lord Asriel as your prisoner. Obviously, Mrs. Coulter is a liar and a manipulator, but the way Ruth Wilson plays this character is so good. She's just so good at turning it, you know, manipulating the situation and deceiving everyone. She's a very deceitful character. She's a wicked woman, but she's so complicated. She's so captivating to watch. I don't know, there's just something about her that I just love, absolutely love. Dafne Keane as well continues to be very charming as Lyra. I think by this point she's gotten more confident. I think she's very much suited in this role. She still has a few more challenging scenes up ahead in the future episodes. We won't spoil them, but there's definitely a lot more from her to give, and I like her in this one, and I like her interactions with Scoresby, particularly when she says, oh, you know, we're gonna, you know, the way she talks about playing cards with him and when she steals his breakfast. And in that particular scene, I think Dafne Keane really shines. And I think the production design is very good, like the set of the bar and obviously the Magisterium and everything. So there's certainly a few more progressions in the story. And by the end of the episode, the Egyptians and Yurik and Lyra and Scoresby, they're leaving Trollesund. They're going off to continue their journey. There's also this other character called Sisselman, who's actually played by an actor called Harry Melling, who, if you remember, he's in the Harry Potter movies. He plays Dudley. And I know I recognised him from somewhere, but I didn't realise it was him until I looked it up on the cast list. So it's nice to see him in it. He plays a nice Weasley character, and he nearly gets trampled on by Yurik at the very end, and he has a run-in with Lee Scoresby at the beginning. If I had any criticisms, maybe the pacing is a tad bit slow at the beginning. That's why I do think these episodes could have been reduced to 45 minutes. Then it just would have allowed things to be a lot tighter, but that's just my opinion. And another thing as well, Father Corum, we get to learn a bit more about his backstory, how tragically he lost his son. Him and the witch, Seraphina Pecola, they were together for a time, and then they lost their son, and then Seraphina kind of went mad through her grief, and she wanted to destroy the world, and things seemed to end very badly for them. I think James Cosmo played that scene really well, where he breaks down and talks about his son's demise. It's a really tragic moment, and he's with Lyra for most of the episode, and he's allowing Lyra to kind of take the lead, and he completely trusts her with what she's doing, and she has the alethiometer, of course, so she knows how to read it. And he's kind of puzzled as to how she can do that. She obviously has some major gift, which is interesting. And there's still quite a lot of mystery surrounding that. So overall, I think this is a really good episode. It is fantastic. It's a little slow to the start, but once it gets going, it's very good. And by this point, the show has definitely won me over, and I would definitely continue it. If you haven't been hooked on the show by this point, then there's no point watching the rest of it. As for me, I'm going to score this one a 10 out of 10. Some minor pacing doesn't prevent it from being awful for me, or from being lower than a 10. I might be generous, but that's just my opinion. Okay, thank you very much for watching my review of His Dark Materials. Stay tuned next time when I review Episode 5, The Lost Boy. So until then, I'm Mr. TARDIS11. See you soon. Bye for now.